All thanks and praises unto our power, Yahweh, Bahasham, Yahweh Shai, Bahasham Wabrakakwadash. Peace, blessings, much respect to the elders and the apostles of Great Millstone, on down to the rest of the elders who rule well within Israel. Salutations to the hopeful elect throughout the four corners of this whole entire earth, no matter where, whom they may be, or what they may look like, pushing out this purified truth to the rest of the church who believe as well. You men who may not be teachers or prophets, you women, sons, and daughters also. Tawada to Yahweh Shai, because without Yahweh Shai, enduring and going to that cross for the nation of Israel and the nation of Israel alone, none of this would even be possible whatsoever. This is the book of Ephesians chapter 5 and verse 1. Be ye therefore followers of the power as dear children. So we are to be as the Heavenly Father. We are to be like Yahweh in the name Yahweh Shai. Because we don't have direct access to the Heavenly Father. We have to go through Yahweh Shai. Okay? That's why we say Yahweh Bahasham Yahweh Shai. It may come off kind of long. It may come off like a catchphrase to the world. But it's not a catchphrase. Everything that we do in this ministry, it's not to set trends or to be trendy. We do things through the Holy Spirit. And we are to be followers of the Heavenly Father, Yahweh, through His only begotten Son, Yahweh Shai. And one thing about the Heavenly Father, one of His traits, He is not a respecter of persons. To be a respecter of person, that's a female trait. That's not a manly trait. To discriminate one man under another based off of your own personal feelings, that's being a respecter of persons, right? Be ye therefore followers of the power as dear children. Let's touch on Acts. Chapter 10. In verse 34, then Peter opened his mouth and said, of a truth, I perceive that the power is no respecter of persons. So the Heavenly Father is not a respecter of persons. And we ourselves are to be like the Heavenly Father. And part of being like the Heavenly Father is not being a respecter of persons. So an example of a respecter of persons may be, you and another brother may have a close bond. And then, within this close bond, you and this brother may also have some of the same likes. You both may like sports. You both may favor the same sports team. You both may have certain things that make you close. But then you'll outcast another brother who's in this ministry who may not share some of those same interests as you two brothers. So if you and one of your brothers who's close to you, right, if you were to see one of you go off, you don't say nothing. But the other brother who doesn't share y'all's interests, he might not be into sports. He might not be into the same things that y'all are into. He may not be as close in terms of, you know, the bond that you two may have. So you outcast him and you shun him. You're quick to point the finger at him. Or when he says something, you overlook what he says. You never have any fairness and judgment. That's being a respecter of persons. We're supposed to be like the Heavenly Father. Then Peter opened his mouth and said, of a truth I perceive that the power is no respecter of persons. So we can't be discriminating on another brother because, well, I like video games and he doesn't. So if he does something that goes off in terms of what the scripture says is wrong, I'm going to get on him. But this brother, because he likes video games like me and we share that interest, I'm going to pretend like I didn't see him do what he just did. Or anytime he says something, I'm gonna listen to him because that's my guy. But him, that brother over there, I ain't listening to him, although he's coming out the scriptures. That's a respecter of persons. The Lord ain't dealing with that. Okay? Let's go to 1 Samuel. You know what? I'll get that next. Let's go to Isaiah. Chapter 13 and verse 14. And it shall be as the chaste roe. Let me see. Acts 13 and 22. And when he had removed him, he raised up unto them David to be their king, to whom also he gave testimony, and said, I have found David, the son of Jesse, a man after mine own heart, which should fulfill all my will. So we're hoping to be of the house of David. David himself was a man after the Lord's heart. So seeing that David was a man after the Lord's heart, the scriptures tell you in Jeremiah that when it comes to our own personal heart, Jeremiah 17 and 9, the heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? That's why things can pop in your head and it's like, how in the hell, where did that come from? Why did that just come into my mind like that? But that just shows you that the mind itself is deceitful, okay? The heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? Well, the Lord knows it, and the Lord knows that it's wicked. That's why we are to be as the Heavenly Father. We are to be as David was, okay? We're to follow after the mind of the Most High. And the mind of the Most High, guess what? He's not a respecter of persons. Acts 13 and 22. And when he had removed him, he raised up unto them David to be their king, to whom also he gave testimony and said, I have found David, the son of Jesse, a man after mine own heart, which shall fulfill all my will. So David wasn't a respecter of persons, because David was a man after the Most High's heart. And Yahweh Bashem Yahweh Shai is not a respecter of persons. That's why I read in Ephesians 5 and 1, we're supposed to be like the Most High. We're supposed to be like His children, okay? But to be a respecter of persons is a female trait. That's what happened between David and Saul. Let's get that account. Matter of fact, before I get that account, let's go back to where I said I was going to go. Let's go to 1 Samuel. Chapter 16 and verse 7. But the Lord said unto Samuel, look not on his countenance or on the height of his stature, because I have refused him. For the Lord seeth not as man seeth. For man looketh on the outward appearance, but the Lord looketh on the heart. So the Lord is looking on the heart of man. All right? The Lord is not a respecter of persons. Brethren, they might look up to someone because, oh, you know, he's tall, you know, he lifts weights all the time, right? He's well versed in the scriptures. He may be a guy with a really long beard. His beard touches his damn chest. He might be a guy who shares the same interests as he does. He might like football. And then the guy that can teach real well, he happens to like football a lot too. So they'll talk about sports a lot on the side. So anytime he says something, it's on point no matter what. You know? But that's not how you judge matters. That's not how you're supposed to be. Let's read this again in 7. But the Lord said unto Samuel, look not on his countenance. So rather a man is buff, a man can be tall, all right? A man can be handsome, a man can have a big ass beard on his face, all right? Or on the height of his stature, because I have refused him. For the Lord seeth not as man seeth. For man looketh on the outward appearance, but the Lord looketh on the heart. And that's what people do. People judge matters off of what a person looks like. So if one brother happens to be more handsome than the other, people will take up for him. Kind of like what Absalom, King David's son, who tried to kill him. He was known to be a handsome man. And based off of his looks alone, he took the heart of the people. Because people look on the outward appearance. But that's not a godly trait. That's a worldly trait. Alright? That's what women do. Now let's stay in Samuel's. And let's go to chapter 18. 1 Samuel's chapter 18 and verse 6. And it came to pass as they came, when David was returned from the slaughter of the Philistine, that the women came out of all cities of Israel, singing and dancing, to meet King Saul with tabrets, with joy, and with instruments of music. So these women, they first came to see Saul. Their intent first was to meet up with Saul. But guess what happened? Verse 7. And the women answered one another as they played and said, Saul has slain his thousands and David his 10,000. So these women were speaking among themselves and their mind frame was like, Saul, he's killed a lot of men, but David, he's killed even more men, right? And Saul was very wroth, and the saying displeased him. And he said, they have ascribed unto David 10,000s, and to me they have ascribed but thousands. And what can he have more but the kingdom? So based off of these women being a respecter of persons, right? Because although their intention was to sing and dance to meet with King Saul, but guess what? They ended up really diverting their attention from Saul to David based off of David having more bodies, so to speak. And I ain't talking about bodies in terms of a whore who's sleeping with a lot of men. I'm speaking of bodies as in a man who's a man of war. All right. So these women were being discriminative. They were discriminating against Saul, showing favoritism to David. Because being a respecter of persons, that is a female's trait. Okay? That is not a godly trait. That's why a woman needs a man as her head. Because her on her own, she is destructive. She does everything anti the scriptures. Okay? And there's not going to be a respecter of persons when the Lord starts to bring judgment. Which judgment's already here. But as judgments increase, the Lord's not going to be a respecter of persons for any of us. Right is right, wrong is wrong. Now there's room for mercy and grace, but that doesn't give us room to be niggards. That doesn't give us room to be willful sinners and to look upon a man based off of his views, his height, how big his beard is, how well he speaks, how well known he is amongst Israelites. Okay? We have to be fair in terms of our judging, how we see things. Now, there's nothing wrong with being joined into a brother, you know, y'all are real close, but that shouldn't give you any excuse to discriminate against another brother who may not be in y'all's inner circle, because right is right, wrong is wrong, regardless of who it is. Okay? Don't prefer one over the other. Let's go to 1 Timothy. 1 Timothy chapter 5 and 21. I charge thee before the power and the Lord Yahawashi Mashiach and the elect angels that thou observe these things without preferring one before another, doing nothing by partiality. So we can't be partial, because being partial makes you a respecter of persons. You preferring one over another, right? It's like, yeah, I like this brother's videos, but he ain't all that popular. But this brother over here, man, this brother be going deep, man. This brother be going into them breakdowns, man. You know, you got a lot of funny, weird acting Israelites who act like women in this ministry. They'll prefer one before another. It's like, no, I don't watch his videos because we don't talk. But I'll watch his videos, man. We be talking on the phone. We be talking about football. That's retarded, man. That shit weird. Anyway, I charge thee before the power in the Lord Yahawashai Mashiach and the elect angels, that thou observe these things without preferring one before another, doing nothing by partiality. So we're not to be partial in this ministry. Okay, let's go into that word partiality in Greek 43:46. The word is prosklisis, an inclination or proclivity of mind, a joining the party of one partiality. From a compound of Greek 43:14 and Greek 28:27, a leaning towards, that is, proclivity, partiality. So when you think of partiality, or when you hear the word partiality, I should say, you think of the word partial. But then it said proclivity. And proclivity, I would think that's like something that's bent. It's not really straight. It's kind of crooked. Right? Something that's... I'll probably just stick with that to keep it simple. Something crooked. Okay? So when someone's partial, they're crooked. They're not coming straight. They're not being straight up. Okay? So we can't be partial. We can't be a respecter of persons. We got to be fair in judgment, man. The Lord is making us a kingdom of kings and priests. And being a kingdom of kings and priests, we can't be partial, man. We can't be a respecter of persons. All right? Because the Lord himself doesn't even take reward. I'm going to close it there. Deuteronomy chapter 10, verse 17. For the Lord your power is the power of gods and Lord of lords, a great power, a mighty and a terrible, which regardeth not persons nor taketh reward. And we're supposed to be as the Heavenly Father. We shouldn't look at a man based off of what man sees in things, how man sees things, but how the Lord will see things. But one thing we can't do, we can't look upon the heart of man like the Lord can. So even though we try not to be partial, we try not to be a respecter of persons, ultimately, we don't know the true intent of man. All we can do is go off of a man's actions, how a man moves, how a man goes about his life, how he carries himself. That's how we go by things. Okay, but the Lord goes even deeper. He's looking at a man's intention. And you can't deceive the Lord. You can't bribe the Lord with the reward and say, oh Lord, if you give me the Holy Spirit, I'll give you my house. I'll give you everything I have. It don't work like that. Okay? So Lord willing, this was simple and edifying. I'm going to give all thanks and praises unto our power. Yahweh, Bahashem, Yahweh Shai, Bahashem, Wa Rakakwadash, Shalom.